Hi, welcome to Math Teacher Lounge. I'm Bethany Lockhart-Johnson.
And I'm Dan Meyer.
We have been talking about how do we find math all around us? How do we mathematize public spaces? And we are so excited to have the folks from Public Math back with us. And we have a little game for them.
In a previous episode, they talked about how they elicit and layer and enhance mathematics in public places, and they shared with us some of the most spectacular examples of those processes. And so we wanted to try this in a little bit different, a little more challenging in some respects, which is to just toss at them a random noun, might be a person, place, or thing, and see how they would apply their techniques in real time, riffing off of each other. We're just so obsessed with their creative process. Chris and Molly, we're going to toss you a random noun. Feel free to toss a pass at us here. And then once you find a noun that you think like has some promise, let's hear you folks talk about it and turn it into some math in public. Is that going to work for you? This is a website. All it does is pull up random nouns. So I'm gonna set this down to one random noun and rerun it and let us know support.
Next.
I'm gonna burn a pass on that one also. All right, here we go. Toys. Shoot, too broad.
Too easy.
Store. I want to hear. If you can pass on this if you want to, but I'm curious. Let's pick a store. Bethany, let's you and me pick a store here. Let's see what they might do with a particular store. What do you have them do?
What about Trader Joe's?
What do you got, Molly? Where's your mind going?
I mean, I feel like I've been thinking about stores for a while. I mean, pretty much anytime I go to a place, I'm thinking about how could this place be mathematically, create a mathematical experience for people. So the carts, you know, those little advertisements it's in the back of the cart. So if you're like a groom, yes, and you're pushing the cart, you're staring at it, you know, slight dilemma in that if you're a kid sitting in the cart, you're facing the other way. But that space, that is like prime real estate for some type of, you know, math prompt question, something playful.
Beautiful. It's a frame. It's like a frame. And then it's also like a basket in the sense. So like, okay, you can, you know, mathematize like things that you're putting in there. And they have the really Trader Joe's, you know, big fan, holler at me, Trader Joe's. But there's a small little kids cart that I don't know if you ever see the kids rolling around those. Those are like so delightful. Yeah, so there's an opportunity there for a kid specific one.
Well, and you know how Trader Joe's already has that like search for the animal kind of thing?
There's a dinosaur or something like that.
Yeah, well, there's like different mascots that they search for. I'm already like thinking about all the things we could have them search for as they're navigating the store.
All right, number game at Trader Joe's. See you, everyone. We had a great show.
We're all thinking it here. We're all thinking it here. Yeah, but for folks who are coming in from the other episode, number game. Tell how would this work in Trader Joe's?
Can you find one of something, two of something, three of something, multiple blanks, so multiple units? It's a scavenger hunt. Maybe you turn it into the front. You get a sheet of stickers from Trader Joe's.
I'm wondering like how to make it social. Like the cart is shared by multiple customers throughout the day and week and all that, right? Like, is there a way to like kind of leave the residue of the mathematical exploration behind for the previous person, or for the next person rather?
We're really working on not leaving residue around during this time, right? We're really working on the
mathematical residue is the only kind you want to.
The only kind of residue we want.
Like that.
Yeah,
those kinds of interactions are like, oh man, if we stumble on that, I feel like it's gold, where it's like you interacting with someone from the past and then you know that what you're doing is someone from the future will interact with it.
I love it. Let's do one more here. Let's do one more round. I think I'm getting the hang of this a little bit. So this is like my favorite math department right here that we're in right now. This is an amazing conversation. All right. Let's hang here for a second. All right. So like
tools.
Like tools. Kids got tool boxes. People have tool belts, tools, construction sites. Let's interpret this broadly here. Again, we're putting 0 seconds on the clock.
What family? Where's the family tool activity? When I say like conversations and tools or families, like what sites come to mind?
I mean, I thought of automatically the kitchen because of I'm thinking of the tools I use there.
Having like a kitchen set, like here's the kitchen math pack sounds so interesting to me. Like, Because, well, a lot of families, and I speak from my own experience, don't have like, aren't like really well endowed with like lots of tools. My stuff's really kind of just like whatever I kind of cobble together. Like really, like loads of folks have a set of knives or some pots and pans. Like I feel like that's a much more broadly applicable set of tools. And I just love the idea of you folks making a, like whatever the layer is on top of the kitchen set.
That's a good insight, is that like, okay, what if there's a way to take advantage of the cobbled together kitchen, right? So it's like, you've got four different things. I mean, which one doesn't belong comes to mind as like an invitation for folks to gather four objects and to create which one doesn't belong sets and kind of interact with that. But even the right now, something coming to mind is like, okay, if you've got a bunch of different containers of sorts, Tupperwares, measuring cups, whatever, like some challenge to
find the lids.
Yeah. Oh,
because that's pretty much the only I have that challenge every day.
I love how real that is. Yeah. Or like least to greatest, or like, you know, kind of creating an array of something and each direction Ooh. Tells you something about it. That would be fun. These are just be like challenges we throw out for people to do in the snap photos.
I think a big idea or a big question of public math is what else can it do? What else can it do? So I think about if we don't start with the actual hammer as the object, maybe in your junk drawer, like what else can it do in your kitchen? What can, you know, can it hammer? Can it, you know, what else could hammer? So kind of where you take an idea and then, or you, it helps you to relook at something, I guess, and see what math potential it has or what other potential it has. And it's kind of that creativity or looking anew at things. That's one of the key
things and people. I feel like that's the key idea of public math and the what I know of you folks as teachers and people is that you see potential very generously in students. Like what else can the student do? It's like, all right, there's more here. Let's find it. Well, folks, thanks so much for coming on and sharing with us how you see the world, and both from a technical perspective and a creative perspective. It's just a real inspiration, all of your work. So thank you, folks. And Bethany, would you sign us off here and let the audience know where they can find us for more?
If you want to get in touch with Math Teacher Lounge, you can find us on Twitter at MTL Show. You can also find us on Facebook. We have a Math Teacher Lounge space. We've got the link for you, so that you can continue these conversations. We would love to find out, how do you engage with math out in the public? We can't wait to hear about it. If we want to find you, how do we find you, Public Math?
public-math.org is where you will find us and find out whatever new projects we have coming. And we're on Twitter at Public Math as well.